Over the last year, I've posted a bunch of Pokemon facts, like a lot. So I decided for this video, I was gonna put them all together for you guys to enjoy. And I even decided to add in a secret video randomly in between this one. So have fun finding it and subscribe. It would truly mean the world to me. How Ash's Pikachu evolved from Pichu in the Pokemon anime. Ash's Pikachu has got a pretty sad backstory. As a Pichu, he never really got along with his group, since Pichu wasn't that good at using electricity, and one day he got lost and met Kangaskhan. The mother Kangaskhan felt bad that Pichu was abandoned and adopted him into the family. Pichu traveled with the Kangaskhans for a while and even considered the baby Kangaskhan its brother. But there was one big problem. Kangaskhans are normally meant to be carrying around one baby Pokemon, and with two baby Pokemon, the mother Kangaskhan was getting really tired carrying Pichu around. Pichu noticed this and thought of himself as a burden to his mother Kangaskhan and wanted to leave, but the mother Kangaskhan would never let Pichu leave since she considered him one of his own. But unfortunately that night, Pichu made the decision to leave behind his family since he decided it would be easier on them. Because of all this emotional buildup, this Pichu evolved into the Pikachu that we know today that later on went on Ash's journey. Pikachu almost evolved in the Pokemon anime twice. In the Pokemon Black and White anime, Ash meets up with a trainer that thinks Pikachu could get stronger, so he kind of just throws the Thunderstone at Pikachu. Ash reacts quickly and jumps in the way of the Thunderstone, making sure it doesn't hit contact with Pikachu, because if it does, he'll evolve into Raichu. The second time was in the Pokemon Journeys anime, where Ash meets up with a horde of Pikachus. They find Thunderstones laying around in the mountains, and one of the wild Pikachus approaches our Pikachu and chases him around with the Thunderstone, trying to make him evolve. In the end, Ash ends up telling the wild Pikachus that they don't need the Thunderstones, and Pikachu's happy just the way it is. But it does make you think, what would have happened if Ash got a Raichu? Ash's Bulbasaur almost evolved in the Pokemon anime. In the first season of the Pokemon anime, Ash meets his Bulbasaur in the forest where he's the protector of the entire village. Then, once Bulbasaur joins Ash's team, there ends up being a festival where all the wild Bulbasaurs want to evolve into Ivysaurs and Venusaurs. The wild Bulbasaurs kidnap Ash's Bulbasaur since they think he wants to evolve. They bring Ash's Bulbasaur to the leader of the forest, Venusaur, which he forces every single one of the Bulbasaurs to evolve into Ivysaur. When Ash's Bulbasaur refuses to evolve, Venusaur gets mad and strikes Bulbasaur with a vine whip, but Ash jumps in the way. Ash ends up explaining to the Venusaur that his Bulbasaur doesn't want to evolve, but it doesn't make him any weaker for not wanting to. Venusaur still gets mad that Ash's Bulbasaur ruined the festival, and Team Rocket came around and kidnapped all the Bulbasaurs. Ash's Bulbasaur learned the move Solar Beam, freeing all the Bulbasaurs from Team Rocket, and proving that he doesn't need to evolve to be strong. Charmander has a secret evolutionary line, and it's Cubone. There's a popular theory going around that Charmander is the pre-evolution of Cubone and Marowak. This evolution would stem from Charmander witnessing the death of its parent and adopting its skull, evolving it. The theory does have some solid ground since Charmander and Cubone are part of the same egg group, and that Cubone is grieving a loss of their parents. And death isn't uncommon with this species since once the fire on their tail goes out, they're dead. This theory would also explain why Cubone and Marowak are able to learn an ample amount of fire-type moves, since they aren't a fire-type. On top of that, Alolan Marowak is a ghost fire-type, which would explain the typing. And that's why...
How Ash's Charmander evolved in the Pokemon anime.
We all know that Ash found his Charmander after he was abandoned in the rain by his original trainer, and Ash brought him on the team. Charmander was a good Pokemon that listened to Ash, but one day when they were walking down the city, Charmander just randomly evolved into Charmeleon. Things were never the same since then, since Charmeleon viewed Ash as lower than him and would never listen to him. Charmeleon's ego got so big that the only way he could evolve into Charizard is by getting one up by an Aerodactyl. Though seriously, Charmeleon's pride was so hurt that Aerodactyl emoted on him that he evolved. But even with all of this, Charizard did not listen to Ash at all, even costing Ash the Indigo League because Charizard just lays on the ground because he doesn't want to listen to Ash. Because of all this, Ash had to release Charizard to make him become a better Pokemon. This still makes me wonder, how did an innocent Charmander turn into a bratty Charizard? How Ash's Incineroar evolved in the Pokemon anime. In the Pokemon Sun and Moon anime, Ash finds Litten after he refuses to leave its home because his old friend died. After Litten joins Ash's team, they end up fighting Professor Kukui's Incineroar. This Incineroar almost crushed Litten with its bare hands, and it evolved into Torracat. But ever since that day, Torracat vowed to defeat that Incineroar. So near the end of the series, Torracat tries to get his get back and challenges Incineroar to a 1v1. Torracat's one and only goal was to defeat Incineroar as a Torracat, and it didn't want to evolve at all. Torracat ended up using the move Flare Blitz to do the final hit on Incineroar, winning the battle. Torracat finally reached its goal, being able to defeat Incineroar as a Torracat, so it chose to evolve after that battle since it had no reason to stay a Torracat anymore. Funny enough, we never get to see this Incineroar in action.
Pikachu almost evolved a few more times in the Pokemon anime.
In the Pokemon Diamond and Pearl anime, Ash's Pikachu goes up against another Raichu and they get utterly destroyed. Pikachu ends up taking Raichu's Hyper Beam straight to the face, being sent to the emergency room. Brock tells Ash that Pikachu can't learn Hyper Beam without evolving into a Raichu, and Paul, Ash's rival, also tells Ash he should evolve Pikachu to be able to beat the Raichu. In Pikachu's hospital room, Ash leaves the Thunderstone they got in the Kanto region on Pikachu's desk, giving Pikachu the choice if he wants to evolve or not. Pikachu ends up missing and takes the Thunderstone with him, making everyone think Pikachu evolved. Ash went off searching for Pikachu at night and noticed a beam of lightning from the woods. We then see our Pikachu practicing his infamous move Volt Tackle, deciding not to evolve into a Raichu and getting strong his own way.
What happened to Ash's Squirtle? In the first season of the Pokemon anime, Ash encounters the Squirtle Squad, which is a group of Squirtles that were abandoned by their original trainers. After Ash and Squirtle work together to defeat Team Rocket, Squirtle realizes that Ash is a pretty good guy and joins his team. But that's not where it ends. So in the Johto region, when Ash is traveling with Squirtle, he meets another group of Squirtles that are part of a firefighting squad. After spending some time with these firefighting Squirtles, Officer Jenny offers Squirtle to be the leader of this Squirtle Squad. Squirtle ultimately ends up accepting this position, becoming their leader and leaving Ash's team. But we actually do get to see Squirtle again in the future. In the Pokemon Journeys anime, Ash is reunited with his Charizard and Bulbasaur, which have all also left his team. They see a poster of this Squirtle that they recognize since he's got super famous. Ash's Squirtle from all the way back then is now the leader of this Power Ranger type squad of the Squirtle Squad, and they are just super famous around Kanto. Squirtle doesn't end up joining Ash's team again, but they do hang out for old time's sake. Subscribe to join the Squirtle Squad.
Eevee hasn't gotten a new evolution in over 10 years. In the past, Game Freak used to be pretty consistent on when we would get evolutions. Eevee dropped in Gen 1 with 3 forms. Then in Gen 2, we got introduced to Umbreon and Espeon. Then Gen 4, we got introduced to Glaceon and Leafeon. And then in Gen 6, we got introduced to Sylveon. So it seemed like with every other generation, we'd get a new evolution, but Game Freak broke this streak with Gen 8, where they gave us absolutely nothing. And there is actually a reason for this. If you didn't know, Pokemon types are categorized into 2 types, physical and special, and all of Eevee's evolutions fall into the special category. So we basically ran out of special evolutions to use. That's why we haven't seen any rock or fighting type evolutions, since those are physical types and Eevee doesn't evolve into physical types. The only hope for Eevee getting another evolution would be the dragon type, since it's the last evolution that is a special type that hasn't been used yet, and I think it would complement Sylveon pretty well. So that's why.
Times when the Pokemon anime just spoiled the next generation. Right off the bat, in Season 1, Episode 1 of Pokemon, we see Ho-Ho, the legendary Pokemon of Gen 2, in this episode. And this isn't even the last time we've seen a Gen 2 Pokemon in Season 1 of Pokemon. Togepi got introduced in the first season through an egg. So I can understand if kids back then were watching these episodes and confused, since these Pokemon were not in the Gen 1 Pokedex. Zoroark and Zoroark were actually first seen in the Gen 4 Pokemon anime. Zoroark was just this Pokemon that was transforming into anyone and anything, just causing trouble around the city. And as we all know, these Pokemon are from Gen 5, not 4. Another crazy example everyone seems to miss is that Munchlax, the pre-evolution of Snorlax, isn't actually from Gen 3. He was revealed in the Gen 3 anime and shown a lot, since he was literally Max's star Pokemon and one of the staple trios in that gen, but Munchlax actually is from Gen 4, not 3. So that's how.
Times where the Pokemon anime had hidden references that you missed. In Pokemon X and Y, they decided to reference JoJo's Bizarre Adventure by having Meowth do all the JoJo poses and the D-O-R-E. And I mean, it's pretty fitting for Team Rocket to be referencing JoJo. But this isn't as crazy as the time the Pokemon anime referenced Naruto in the Sun and Moon season. They subtly referenced the series by having this trainer's Pikachu have Boruto's haircut. If you didn't know, Naruto's son is Boruto. And if you think this is just a coincidence, this Pikachu's name is literally Boruto. But the craziest and most popular reference of all is when the Pokemon anime references Dragon Ball. This happens at the very end of the Sun and Moon anime at the World Champions, where Pikachu goes Super Saiyan against Professor Kukui, then charges all her energy up in a father-son Kamehameha. If you didn't know, that's Goku's main attack. So subscribe for more facts.
So we all know that the Pokemon anime was meant for kids, right? But what if I were to tell you that there's a Pokemon anime that's super mature? 7 years ago, out of nowhere, the official Pokemon channel uploaded episode 1 of the Pokemon anime, Pokemon Generations, that follows the story of Red and Blue, and it's super gruesome. Like, Charmander and Squirtle are literally biting each other in this. The episode's released weekly, exclusively on YouTube, and it went through the entire Kanto journey and a bit of the Johto journey, too. And oh my goodness, look at this Elite Four animation, man! Like, this is incredible! This series had up to 18 episodes and caught the Pokemon community up with the game lore, which I really liked, and I really think Nintendo should make another series like this, since it was a big success.
When you think of movies that have made you cry in the past, you may think of a tragic romance or even a sad death in a movie, but none of those movies could top the saddest movie of all. The first Pokemon movie. Some of you may think this is weird if you haven't watched the movie, but it truly is the saddest movie. Dog, when Ash got turned to stone, there were tears running down my face. We even had all the clone Pokemon slapping each other and beating each other up. They were so confused and it was just so sad for a young audience as well. I'll even see memes on the internet where people just talk about how this movie made them cry and it still holds up to this day. They just don't be making movies like this before. Like, yeah, they tried to replicate Ash's death in a later Pokemon movie, but it just doesn't hit the same.
Ash's Charizard sucks. Let me explain. In the Pokemon anime, Ash enters the Indigo League, the most important tournament of his life. All his Pokemon are KO'd except Charizard, and he sends him out as his last resort. At first, Charizard listens to Ash and takes down the Charmander in front of him, but then he's faced with Richie's Pikachu. Charizard believed he was better than everyone else in the room and didn't want to listen to Ash and just fell asleep in the middle of the battle, costing Ash to lose the Indigo League. It's really sad to see Ash lose like this, since Charizard wasn't always like this. When he was a Charmander and Charmeleon, he listened to Ash a lot because they believe they're equals. But sometimes when Pokemon get too strong, they get disobedient and don't want to listen to their trainers anymore. So this happened to Ash. But later down the road, he ended up accepting Ash as his true master. Did you know that the creator of Pokemon was actually inspired by insects of all things? Tajiraju was inspired by his childhood hobby of catching insects every day as a kid, and he always imagined playing a video game where you could gather a bunch of different insects around the world and trade them. And with a concept so simple, one of the biggest franchises was born, Pokemon. Subscribe so I can also grow to be one of the biggest channels.
How did Ash, with one of the strongest teams we've ever seen yet, lose in the Kalos League in Pokemon X and Y? In the final match of the Kalos League, Ash was going up against his rival Alon with his Mega Charizard X, while Ash had his infamous Ash Greninja. So with the type advantage Greninja has over Mega Charizard, since Greninja is a water type and Charizard is a fire, you would think Ash had this championship in the bag. Oh, but that's where you're wrong. Greninja and Charizard go neck and neck for the entire battle and almost ending off in a draw, but Ash's Greninja faints first before Alon's Charizard, crowning Alon as a champion. And yeah, Ash did win the Galar League a few seasons later, but that still begs the question, how did Alon's Charizard win with the type disadvantage? And the entire community has just agreed Alon's Charizard's just different.
Which Pokemon is the fastest of all time? In 5th place we got Electrode with a base stat total of 150, which is super surprising because who thought this ball would be this fast? In 4th place we got Faramosa with a speed stat of 151, making it the fastest Ultra Beast. A 3rd place may come as a surprise, but Ninjask is 3rd place with 160 speed stat, which people normally think is the fastest Pokemon, but there's actually 2 ahead of it. In 2nd place we got Deoxys Speed Form with a speed stat total of 180, making it one of the quickest Pokemon you can use in battle, but there's still one ahead of it. Now in 1st place with a speed stat total of 200 is Regilike, and yeah, this is undefeated as the fastest Pokemon of all time.
Did you know that there are some Pokemon with no weaknesses? Sableye and Spiritomb used to have no weaknesses with being the only Dark and Ghost types, but they got nerfed in Gen 6 with the introduction of Fairy types. So now technically every single Pokemon type should have a weakness, but one Pokemon line breaks this completely. Some people believe the Hisuian Zoroark line have no weaknesses due to them being the only Ghost normal types, but they're still weak to Dark. The Pokemon that actually has no weakness is Electros in the entire Timon line. Now yes, since they're electric types, they're weak to ground type moves, but they're the only electric line of Pokemon that have access to the ability Levitate, making them immune to ground type moves. So yeah, they have no weaknesses. Unless you have Mold Breaker, then they're screwed. Subscribe for more Pokemon.
Do you know the most popular Pokemon of all time? Well, number 5, we got Gengar with 110,000 total monthly searches, which isn't surprising since he's a Gen 1 Pokemon and has a lot of cool fan art online.
At number 4, we got Lucario with 120,000 monthly searches, which isn't surprising. Lucario's been a staple since Gen 4 and has a really cool design and a cult following behind him. In 3rd place, we got Sylveon with 137,000 monthly searches, which is crazy and really defining Sylveon as the most popular evolution. In 2nd place we got Gardevoir with 160,000 monthly searches. At first I was surprised that she's all the way up here, then I remembered this is the internet and some of you guys need help. And in 1st place, to no one's surprise, is Charizard with 250,000 total monthly searches, landsliding the competition. And yeah, I think Charizard will always be a staple as the most popular Pokemon. Subscribe for more lists.
Game Freak put UFOs in a Pokemon game. Let me explain.
In Pokemon Black and White 2, there was a PokeStar special event where you could film a movie. This movie completely revolved around space, giving you the ability to find aliens and find UFOs. You could even battle and fight these UFOs with a bit of modding and even add them to your team. Now, these weren't just like background sprites or anything either. These UFOs had literal typings and had Pokedex numbers. Like, look at this Pokedex entry. It is a flying and electric type with the ability Volt Absorb. Its Pokedex entry just reads, it's the UFO one. It's even got a base that total of 600, and if you didn't know, that's what legendary Pokemon have. But the craziest thing is its moveset, since it can only learn 6 moves in total, with the 2 being Bubble Beam and Counter at level 1 and Discharge and Air Slash at its highest level. They even coded in a damn shiny for this thing. I don't know, maybe that's why.
Pokemon theories that just make sense. I think one of the most popular Pokemon theories of all time is that you, the player, in Pokemon Red and Blue, kill your rivals Raticate and SSN. I mean, this theory just makes sense. Your rivals had this Rattata since day 1, and all of a sudden it's gone in the next rival fight. At the Pokemon graveyard, your rival is burying a Pokemon and tells you that at least your Pokemon don't look dead, which sounds pretty resentful, maybe like you killed them. But that's not even one of the most bizarre popular Pokemon theories. Ash being in a coma has been a theory for a long time in the community. Basically, it states that in the first episode of Pokemon, when Ash got attacked by a bunch of sparrows, he didn't actually make it out with Pikachu, but he's actually in a coma, imagining everything, which is why he's never aging, and also why he saw Ho-Ho at the end of the episode, since Ho-Ho lets you live out your hopes and dreams. Some of you guys may not remember, but Ash has been possessed by an evil spirit in the Pokemon anime. Over 14 years ago, Ash went to the Battle Frontier and picked up a Pokeball with the evil King Spirit. And for some reason, when Ash picked up this ball, he hit puberty.
First, you will all bow before me.
No, really, this guy just got the deepest voice in the entire franchise. Evil Ash goes to fight the Battle Frontier and sends out his Sceptile up against Regirock. Then for some reason, this Ash just decides to throw Sceptile to the side because screw Pokemon and tanks the Regirock's Hyper Beam to the face. Most of us don't even remember this episode since it barely aired. The only reason why half of us even know who Evil Ash was is because of some evil YouTube AMVs of Ash 10 years ago. But in typical Pokemon fashion, the power of friendship prevailed since Pikachu kind of just thunderbolted Ash and he turned back to normal. And that's how.
Did you know that zombies actually exist in Pokemon? In the Pokemon manga, when Red is in Lavender Town, he is approached by a Psyduck with blood on his feet. More Pokemon begin to surround him, and then it's revealed that they are all dead zombies. Red tries to attack them with Bulbasaur, but it seems like the attacks just go right through them. When Bulbasaur finally manages to land an attack on one of the zombies, its skin starts falling off and decompresses to bones. Jeez, this is a kid's manga.
It is later revealed that it was a Ghastly that was possessing the tombstones of the already dead Pokemon, which really makes you think how messed up this is. Subscribe for more Pokemon facts. Did you know that only one Pokemon in the entire franchise can de-evolve, and that Pokemon being Slowpoke? The only way for Slowpoke to evolve into Slowbro is by having a Shellder bite the back of its tail. And since technically this evolution is a combination of two Pokemon, if Shellder lets go of Slowpoke's tail, they'll both de-evolve. Hit the subscribe button to save Slowbros from de-evolving. So, we all know that Ghost-type Pokemon are immune to Fighting and Normal-type moves since they're literally ghosts, right? Well, one Pokemon completely breaks this. In the new Pokemon Scarlet and Violet DLC, we're introduced to a brand new Pokemon, Blood Moon Ursaluna. Now, this Pokemon has a pretty groundbreaking ability called Mind Eye, which is exclusive only to Blood Moon Ursaluna. What Mind Eye grants the user is that it ignores its opponent's evasiveness, its accuracy cannot be lowered, and it can also hit Ghost-type Pokemon with Normal and Fighting-type moves. What the? This is like 3 abilities in one. So if you run a lot of ghost type Pokemon, watch out for this mon because he's coming for you. Subscribe for more Pokemon content.
N has a secret identity and it's Zoroark. There's a popular Pokemon theory going around that N from the Unova region is actually a Zoroark and not a human.
This theory stems from the fact that when N was a kid, it's depicted that he lived around Pokemon, more specifically Zorars. N is also one of the few Pokemon trainers in the entire universe that is able to speak fluently with Pokemon and humans. In Pokemon Black and White 2, it's also confirmed that there's a Zoroark that can turn into humans and speak perfectly fine English, so there's that. Not to mention that N's goal in Team Plasma was to free all Pokemon from human captivity, and if I was a Pokemon, that's what my goal would be. And let's be real, the most obvious thing besides N having a Zoroark as a star Pokemon is that N and Zoroark have a striking resemblance to each other. They both got the ponytail the same height, and is literally Zoroark.
When you think of sad Pokemon backstories, names like Cubone and Charmander may come to mind since they're the most well-known backstories. But the saddest backstory in the Pokemon franchise has to be Litten, in my opinion. This Pokemon started off all alone and only had a Scoutland by his side, and he was growing old. Scoutland taught Litten everything he knows, even his fire type moves, and one day Litten fell asleep and had a dream about Scoutland. This dream wasn't much of a dream, it was more of a nightmare because Scoutland kept fading further and further away from the distance, leaving Litten alone, and when Litten woke up, Scoutland was gone. Litten searched everywhere for his friend, but he was nowhere to be seen. Scoutland unfortunately died. The grieving process is really hard for Litten. He didn't eat any food for weeks, but Ash was by his side the entire time trying to support Litten. There was a light at the end of the tunnel though. Litten ended up seeing Scoutland's spirit in the clouds waving him goodbye and telling him to move on, which Litten did. But Litten had even greater challenges to fight, but you have to click down here to watch that.
How Ash caught his only shiny Pokemon. Some of you guys may not know, but Ash has actually managed to catch one shiny Pokemon throughout his entire journey, and this is in season 2 of the Pokemon anime, Pokemon Johto. The gang encounters a group of Noctowls, and there's one that's smaller than the rest of them but has a different colorway, which as we know is a shiny Pokemon, but in the series they don't really acknowledge it as a shiny Pokemon, they just say it looks different, so I guess it doesn't really matter to them. Ash tries to catch this Noctowl, but it doesn't end up working, so he sends out Pikachu and challenges him to a battle. And with Pikachu having the type advantage, he bodies Noctowl, allowing Ash to capture his first and only shiny Pokemon on his run.
So the question that's been on everyone's minds since the dawn of time, how do Pokemon do number 1 and 2? Yes, I know it's gross, but we actually have an answer. With a simple Google search, it says, Pokemon don't pee or poo because their waste byproduct is expelled through the use of their special moves. Yeah. This is why every single Pokemon, regardless of their type, can learn Toxic, the poison type move, since they're literally releasing their toxic waste through their energy. So the next time a Pokemon hits you with a Hydro Pump or a Flamethrower, just know they're actually defecating all over you and not just shooting fire and water. So I guess good move, Nintendo, for keeping the games rated E.
Ash and Pikachu got killed in a banned episode of the Pokemon anime. In the season 1 episode titled The Tower of Terror, Ash and Pikachu walk into the Haunted Tower, where Ghastly Haunter and Gengar drop a chandelier on Ash and Pikachu, killing them. Like, I know it was Halloween, but what were they thinking? The Pokemon end up feeling bad and take Pikachu and Ash's soul out of their body and they turn into ghosts. Ash and Pikachu got to experience what it was like being a ghost, even trying to communicate with Brock and Misty, but they can't see them because they're ghosts. By the end of the episode, Gengar reveals they only dropped the chandelier on their heads because they wanted someone to play with and they put them back in their bodies. But it does make you think, can you get possessed in the Pokemon world?
Pokemon region tier list. I'm going to be ranking them by the region itself, not the game, so don't get salty. Starting off with the Kanto region, I'll have to put it into A tier. It was the first region, so I'll cut it a little bit of slack, but it does lack a lot of Pokemon diversity since you can run into the same Pokemon a lot, but honestly, it is a solid region overall. Moving on to Johto, this is going to hurt my heart, but I'm putting it to B tier because as a region itself, it is kind of lacking. Not a lot there is memorable, and it does piggyback a lot off of what Kanto has done, not adding a unique elements to this region. Moving on to the Hoenn region, I'm gonna have to put it into A tier. It is super memorable. Yes, it does have a lot of water, but it brought a lot of unique elements to the Pokemon franchise, like the Battle Frontier and land event Pokemons like Deoxys. This may be a hot take, but Unova and Sinnoh region are going right into S tier because they both got Pokemon creation lore about how the world was created. We got snow biomes, desert biomes, and everything we gotta ask for. These regions are S tier. Kalos region is going into C tier because it's really just copying Unova's flow with the city vibes. I'm running out of time. Subscribe if you want to see part 2.
This guy has the world record for beating the entirety of Pokemon Red in under 2 minutes. But how is this possible?
Well, you see, there's two main ways people speedrun Pokemon games. There's the any percent speedruns, which allows you to beat the game by any means possible, glitches included.
And there's the any percent glitchless speedruns, where you just beat the game without doing any glitches. But since Pokemon Red is so old, any playthrough of this game should be considered glitchy.
The world record holder, Gorgor, boots up the game as fast as possible and doesn't even name his rival. The second he loads into his room, he's saves and restarts the game, then plays around with his menu so much that his game starts glitching and shows a bunch of gold teeth and hyper potions. Then to the untrained eye like myself, it looks like he's just button mashing, but there's actually a combination that he does which tricks the game into thinking you beat it and playing the credit scene. And in the credit scene, the game says that you somehow own 96 Pokemon but only seen 11. And that's how.
Do humans in the Pokemon world eat Pokemon? Well, that's kind of complicated. Let me explain.
In Pokemon Gold and Silver, we learned that humans cut off Slowpoke's tails to sell them as food and put them in curry. Some trainers see it as wrong and inhumane, and other trainers just eat it up. Funny enough, we know that animals used to exist at some points within the Pokemon world, but they got extinct over time and Pokemon took over as the dominant species.
But this fact is pretty inconsistent since we have seen animals in the Pokemon anime. In the earlier seasons, we even see Ash and Brock dreaming about eating a Magikarp too, so I guess it's not that uncommon. I don't think we'll ever truly get an official answer from Nintendo, since why would they want to confirm that trainers are literally eating Pokemon, but a lot of evidence points towards it. I guess we're gonna have to assume all the meat we've seen in the Pokemon anime and games are just plant-based. Anyway, subscribe for more Pokemon content.
Did you know that instead of Pikachu, Clefairy was actually supposed to become the face of Pokemon? In the Pokemon anime, Clefairy was actually set to be Ash's original Pokemon starter instead of Pikachu. But due to some last minute changes, they ended up giving Pikachu the role instead. Can you imagine a world where Clefairy is the mascot of Pokemon?
How Dawn and Piplup met in the Pokemon anime. When Dawn became a brand new trainer, she met Piplup flying out of the forest with webs on its shoulder. Dawn ends up catching Piplup and notices that something's wrong. This Piplup is super stubborn, and Dawn and Piplup bicker back and forth, and Dawn even tries to feed this Piplup food, but it's not really rocking with it. Then out of nowhere, a group of Ardeoses come and start attacking Piplup, which explains why Piplup had the webs around him at the beginning. Piplup was getting jumped. Ariados hits them with a domain expansion, trapping them in the web. Dawn finds an opening, but then gets trapped by the Ariados' web. Then these raging Pokemon are about to use Poison Sting on Dawn, but Piplup jumps in the way and uses the move Bide, which absorbs all the attacks coming towards her and blasts them right back at them. Piplup won the 1v9.
You may know Pokemon as this safe, family-friendly brand, but oh no no, Pokemon wasn't always like this. Back in the 90s, when Pokemon first released, Nintendo wanted it to get a little more popular, so they released the Pokemon manga. It followed the typical story of Red going through the Kanto region, wanting to become the Pokemon champion, but with a little twist. This series was super brutal. From Pokemon literally getting murdered in battle, or ghost Pokemon possessing humans, or even the Elite Four nuking entire cities because they want to, this story was super intense. Reading these mangas as a kid were actually pretty cool, since it gave more of a realistic approach of what Pokemon would be like in the real world. People would use Pokemon to commit crimes, or people would kill Pokemon. It's just what happens, and this manga showed us that side of the Pokemon world you would never think Nintendo would want to bring to light. But that's why.
What happened to Ash's Butterfree? Butterfree was one of the first Pokemon Ash ever caught and was an early staple on his team. Caterpie was one of the first Pokemon to ever evolve on Ash's team, turning into Metapod and then Butterfree. But later down the line in the Pokemon anime, we end up meeting a super rare pink Butterfree, which ends up vibing really well with our Butterfree. There ends up being an event where all the Butterfrees migrate together and travel across the world so they can start families, and our Butterfree gets invited by the pink Butterfree to go along with her. But for Butterfree to be able to make this decision, he would have to leave Ash's team, since all the other Butterfrees are traveling around the world while Ash is still staying in Kanto. Ash ends up letting Butterfree be able to go along with his people, and it was a pretty sad episode where all the cast was crying. But it still makes me think, how did we get a pink Butterfree since the shiny Butterfree isn't pink? Ash's Pikachu almost got abandoned in the Pokemon anime. In season 1 of Pokemon, Ash and the gang are traveling through a forest where they meet a group of Pikachus. And Ash's Pikachu ends up vibing really well with them, he's almost like a brother to them. Ash sees how happy Pikachu is becoming and starts to think to himself, maybe Pikachu belongs in the wild with a bunch of other Pikachus rather than traveling with him around the world. So that night, Ash made a pretty tough decision, deciding to leave Pikachu behind at the forest since he believes he belongs there. Even Brock and Misty were confused because Pikachu didn't seem like he wanted to stay there, he just was having a fun time vibing with his people. Even through all that, our Pikachu didn't hesitate for a second to keep following Ash since he knows he belongs with them, and the army of Pikachus even waved them off goodbye, and Ash was very happy that our Pikachu joined them along. But that makes me wonder, what would have happened if Pikachu stayed at the forest? Did you know that Pikachu and Raichu, the mascots of the Pokemon franchise, have a scrap third evolution? A few years back, the Pokemon Gold and Silver demo was leaked online, and we saw a ton of scrap Pokemon in those data files, and one of them being Gorachu, the third evolution to Pikachu and Raichu. Gorachu was meant to be this mouse lightning god of the region, and we only ever got to see its back sprite. The only reason why Gorachu wasn't able to make it into the game is because of the limited memory the Game Boy had at the time, so we got Pichu instead, a pre-evolution which costed less memory. I do think Game Freak has had a lot of opportunities to implement Gorachu into the main games. I mean, Raichu could have got a Mega Evolution, we could have got a Gigantamax form, or some new variation of Pikachu, so maybe time will tell. We might see Gorachu. The first time how Pikachu almost evolved in the Pokemon anime. In season 1 of Pokemon, Ash challenges Lieutenant Surge, the third gym leader in the Kanto region, where he was super inexperienced and got bodied by Lieutenant Surge Raichu. Lieutenant Surge makes fun of Ash for not evolving Pikachu into a Raichu and calls him a useless pet since he can't learn all the electric type moves Raichu can learn. Raichu ended up sending our Pikachu to the hospital, and Nurse Joy overheard the struggle Ash was having and gave him the Thunderstone if he wanted to evolve Pikachu. Ash and Pikachu end up having a prep talk if they want to evolve, and Pikachu decides to slap that Thunderstone out of Ash's hands and lets him know he wants to beat Lieutenant Surge's Raichu as a Pikachu and not by evolving. And it paid off, since Pikachu did beat that Raichu.
How Ash's Turtwig got worse the more it evolved.
In the Pokemon world, you'd expect your Pokemon to get stronger the more it evolves, and with the Turtwig line, this is still true.
When Ash first got Turtwig, he was super good, being able to maneuver through a bunch of battles and get Ash tons of wins. This Turtwig was a menace.
Then later on, when this Turtwig was in a major battle when he had a type disadvantage, he decided to evolve and still had that same cold energy.
And just like any other Pokemon, this Squirtle was an MVP on Ash's team because he evolved and got stronger. So you would think the same thing would have happened when this Squirtle evolved into a Torterra.
He evolved into Torterra after beating Team Rocket, but you would think Torterra would have became better, but he became significantly worse.
From this point forward, Torterra never won a single battle in the Pokemon anime, no kidding, making him Ash's worst Pokemon ever.
Pokemon tier list time, and today we're ranking the legendary trios. Starting off with Gen 1, we got the legendary bird trio, and honestly I'm putting them at A tier because they're the first ones to do it and got a pretty cool theme, and they're a staple of what a legendary trio Pokemon has to be. Moving on to the Johto region, we got the legendary dogs, and these goats are going into the S tier because honestly, they're so cool in the way you catch them, the designs are just better than the legendary birds, and they're just the pinnacle of what a trio Pokemon has to be. Now moving on to Gen 3, we got the Regis, and these guys are mediocre and going into B tier. Like, they're just average and kind of underwhelming, and then they're not even the best trio Pokemon in their own generation. Because in Gen 3, we can't forget about the goats, Groudon, Rayquaza, and Kyogre, and these guys are going right into A tier. The first box art legendary trios, and no one really does it better than them. Now for Gen 4, let's just put these abominations into D tier. Are these really anyone's favorites for a legendary trio? But speaking of favorites, let's put the absolute goats into S tier, the creation trio, because no one really does it better than them and their concept is so cool. I'm running out of time, subscribe for part 2. How Meowth learned to talk in the Pokemon anime. Meowth is the only Pokemon in the show that we know that is able to speak fluent English and walk around like a human. Not many people know why he's actually able to do this. A lot of people just think it's a gag, but there is actually a backstory behind it. When Meowth was a stray cat, he had a crush on his female Meowth, but she rejected him because she didn't want to deal with street cats. So Meowth went the nuclear option and changed his entire personality and self to try to become a gentleman for her. He learned how to walk upright, and he overheard humans who were trying to learn English and eavesdropped on their lessons every single day until he was good enough at English himself. But there was one major problem with all of this. Meowth was seen as an outcast to the other Meowths in Persian since he was completely different. So when he went up to the girl to show him that he's a gentleman, she still rejected him, so Meowth now had no one. That's why Meowth travels around with Team Rocket, since he's not accepted by humans and he's not accepted by his own kind, so he's only accepted by these guys. So we've all seen Ash going from this weak little trainer to being one of the strongest in his entire universe, so that begs the question, who's actually better than him? The first trainer to come to mind is Red, since he is the Pokemon champion of the Kanto region, and he has a similar team to Ash with Pikachu being the ace, but Red isn't canon at all to the Pokemon anime, so I don't think he counts. Next up, I'll give it to Leon, since he was the old Pokemon champion and is considered the world's strongest trainer, so he would give Ash a run for his money.
Yes, I know Ash does have the title of the world champion now. It's pretty clear from a story perspective that Leon is stronger than Ash, plus Ash has a problem with defeating Charizards. Last on the list, I'll give it to Cynthia. Yes, we did see in the anime that Ash did beat Cynthia, but I feel like this battle could go either way.
She is still considered the strongest in Gen 4, plus I still have some PTSD from her in the games.
These are some strange Pokemon Mandela effects. Do you notice anything off about this Pikachu?
Well, if you look closely, this Pikachu has a black tail, and Pikachu has never had a black tail, but many Pokemon fans believe at some point in time Pikachu did have a black tail design variation, but in reality, it's just never been the case. Now, what's the name of this Pokemon? A lot of us, including myself, call this Pokemon Unknown, but it's actually called Unknown. Now, what Pokemon type is Golduck? A lot of us seem to think it's water psychic, but it's never been a psychic type at all. It just has access to a plethora of psychic type moves. Now Ninetales, the literal fox Pokemon with nine tails, you would think is spelt like this, but in actuality, it's spelt like this. Now lastly, ground type Pokemon have never resisted fire type Pokemon's moves. They've always just been neutral attacks. Comment down below if you got shocked by any of these facts, and subscribe, please, we're so close to 1k.
how Ash died in the Pokemon anime. Ash is one of the few trainers that has had a couple of deaths in the Pokemon series, and the first time Ash died was in the first Pokemon movie. In this movie, Ash and his gang goes to an island where Mewtwo is the villain and he's fighting against Mew and a bunch of clone Pokemon. Since Ash is a kind trainer, he really hates it when Pokemon fights, and that's what happens on this island. Every single Pokemon is fighting each other. Mewtwo's main goal was to create an army of clone Pokemon to prove their superiority over regular Pokemon, while Mew wanted to keep the balance of having regular Pokemon be the dominant species. Mewtwo and Mew go for a devastating final attack, but Ash runs in the middle of it, dying and turning into stone. Ash made this sacrifice so the Pokemon would stop fighting, and Pikachu tried reviving Ash by using Thundershock, but that didn't work. All the regular and clone Pokemon came together and realized Ash's sacrifice opened their eyes that they shouldn't be fighting, and their tears brought back Ash to life. Sometimes the Pokemon anime gets way too dark, like that one time Ash's Gengar got abandoned. In Pokemon Journeys, Ash's Gengar used to belong to another trainer who had a lot of bad luck, and his logical conclusion is that Gengar cursed him because he's a ghost type Pokemon, so he abandoned him in a mansion. And this Gengar, being the loyal Pokemon he was, waited over 3 years for his trainer to come back. This Gengar felt invisible since he would never reveal himself to other people that entered the mansion and only wanted to be seen by his original trainer. This all changed one day when Gengar actually found his original trainer and he overheard him talking trash about him. Gengar was rightfully upset and launched a shadow ball right at this trainer trying to kill him. But Ash's Pikachu got in the way, deflected the shadow ball, and Gengar actually ended up joining Ash's team since Ash actually cares for his Pokemon, unlike these bums. How Ash's Infernape evolved in the Pokemon anime. In Pokemon Diamond and Pearl, Ash's Chimchar's original trainer was Paul, who was actually abusing Chimchar since he was too weak and couldn't evolve. When Ash figured out what was going on, he brought Chimchar onto his own team since he believed in Chimchar's great potential. Then later on, when Ash and Paul were having a rival battle, Chimchar wanted to get his get back, so he evolved into Monferno to try to beat the Electrobuzz. Even though Chimchar evolved, he still ended up losing the fight, but it proved to Paul that Chimchar had the potential to evolve. Then later on in the Pokemon anime, Ash's Monferno goes crazy because of his ability Blaze, which makes him attack everything around him. Monferno was so blinded by rage, he was so close to killing the Pokemon around him, but Ash jumped in the way and calmed down Monferno, telling him that he was a strong Pokemon. Due to all this, Monferno evolved into Infernape at that very moment, being able to control his Blaze ability so he could truly become a strong Pokemon. Nintendo did the impossible and brought back Mega Evolution, something they said they would never bring back. Over the years, Game Freak has been testing out new gimmicks with every single Pokemon game, with the latest being Terastallization, where you're able to turn into any Pokemon type. In the past, you were able to Gigantamax any Pokemon to being big, but it seems like the fan favorite was Mega Evolutions. You were able to evolve Pokemon that just wouldn't be able to evolve. And yeah, they were super broken competitively, but they are a pretty cool concept overall. And today, Game Freak pulled a bait and switch by announcing Pokemon Legends Z, bringing us back to the Kalos region where Mega Evolution first originated from. So, in 2025, when these games come out, we're probably going to be seeing a lot more Mega Evolutions. Me, personally, I want to see Mega Incineroar since he wasn't out when Mega Evolutions were a thing, but which Mega Pokemon do you guys want to see? Ash caught 30 new Pokemon in a banned episode. In the season 1 episode titled The Legend of Dratini, we see Ash head to the Safari Zone where he gets held at gunpoint. Not just once, this is one of the rare cases in Pokemon's where guns are everywhere. Ash gets access to the Safari Zone and goes crazy and catches 30 Tauroses. We also get the debut episode for Dratini, the pseudo-legendary Pokemon of the region. Because of the heavy use of guns and Ash almost getting killed, we never got to saw this episode on TV and it only aired in Japan. That's why in the Hoenn region it was weird when Ash whipped out a Tauros, because to the US audience, we've never seen this Pokemon before. At least they didn't ban hitting that subscribe button. Times where trainers just abandoned their Pokemon. In the Pokemon anime, some kids just shouldn't be owning Pokemon because a lot of them just throw them away when they don't want them anymore. Like that one time this kid had a Bulbasaur, put him on a cardboard box and sailed him down the river because he couldn't evolve. Like, man, it's on you why your Pokemon can't evolve, not them. Then there was that time with Ash's Tepig where his old trainer just left him on a post to rot because he wasn't strong enough. Like, what? And don't even get me started on Ash's Chimchar too, because Paul was about to abandon this monkey if he wasn't secretly OP. But the original Pokemon abandonment story takes place in the Kanto region with Ash's Charmander, where his old trainer Damien left him to die on a rock because he wasn't strong enough. And this had some serious long-lasting effects on Charmander, which made him never the same. And if you want to know the full story, click down here to see it. These are some of the most stupidest Pokeballs in existence. Let's get one of the biggest offenders out of the way, the Repeat Ball. This Pokeball gives you a 3.5% catch rate on Pokemon you already registered in your Pokedex. Who thought of this? Because I would have already caught the Pokemon by then. Why would I need to catch it again? Let's get right into our next offender, the Nest Ball. At first glance, you wouldn't think it's that bad. The Nest Ball increases the catch rate of Pokemon depending on what level it is. But here's the thing. If the Pokemon's over level 30, it just has a normal catch rate. And you want to know when you have enough money to buy a Nest Ball in most games? By the time Pokemon are not level 30 anymore. This thing is basically useless in a glorified Pokeball.
Lastly, we got the Heal Ball. Yes, it's pretty, it's wonderful, it's colorful, but it is literally useless. It has the same catch rate as a normal Pokeball, and it just heals the Pokemon you caught. Like, I wasn't gonna go to the Pokemon Center anyways. This thing is very, very useless, so the only reason I can see someone using it is because it looks nice. Subscribe for more Pokemon content!
How Ash's Sceptile evolved in the Pokemon anime. When Ash went to the Hoenn region, he got into a 1v1 with a wild Treecko. He ended up winning and catching him. Later down the line, Ash was battling another trainer's Loudred. He sent out Treecko, and Treecko was absolutely destroying him, so Loudred decided to evolve, and Treecko decided to one-up him by evolving into Grovyle. But it doesn't stop there. Later down the line, Grovyle had a crush on a Meganium, and he always wanted to get her attention. When Grovyle thought he was finally in his bag and was going to get with this Meganium, he realized the hard truth. This Meganium is already seeing the Tropius. Grovyle was butthurt, but then Team Rocket ended up catching Tropius and Meganium, and that kind of pissed off Grovyle a lot, evolving him into Sceptile and freeing up Meganium. But even after that, Meganium did not want to get with Sceptile.
Pokemon proves that some people shouldn't be Pokemon trainers. Like that one time Ash found a Tepig in the wild, thinking that he was lost from his trainer, and when he finally found the trainer, he said he abandoned him and threw Tepig at Ash.
Or like the most infamous time with Charmander, where Ash found him out laying in the rain on the verge of death since his fire on his tail was about to go out.
And the only reason why Charmander was out here in the first place was because his trainer thought he was weak and abandoned him. The same thing also happened to Ash's Chimchar with Paul, where Paul just abandoned Chimchar for being weak, but at least Chimchar got his get back when he joined Ash's team. But what's with fire Pokemon getting abandoned?